Science, faith, origins. How can we know about science, faith, and origins? I'm a historian of science and a philosopher of science, and I've developed some tools that would help you to better evaluate science, faith, and origins, especially controversies over origins. Where did we come from? What's the meaning of life? My peers, who are historians of science and philosophers of science, agree that these fields legitimately address the relation between reason and faith, or particularly science and faith. But most scientists are actually so specialized that they're not typically equipped to address these questions. So within the history and philosophy of science, my expertise is in what are called theory virtues, or theoretical virtues. Now, by theory virtues, I mean the virtues or the good traits of a theory, not moral virtues, which would be what would make a person good, but rather theory virtues, which makes for a good theory. Now, the two are related because there's growing cases of scientific misconduct in which scientists falsify data. So being a good person is related to good theory making, but they're largely disconnected for the most part. So what are the traits of a good theory? That is, traits that indicate likely truth, or at least it's worth accepting a theory tentatively until a better one comes along. Well, I've put a lot of thought to this, and it turns out that there are about a dozen major theory virtues that will provide for you the tools to better evaluate claims in science, claims in religious faith, and about origins, where often both science and faith are involved. Let me give you a couple of examples of theory virtues. The most obvious one is evidential accuracy. I mean, the first job of a theory is to make sense of the evidence that's already at hand. But over time, if a theory shows that it stimulates additional discovery, well, this trait of a theory, seen only over time, is known as fruitfulness. I've published an essay about this in a European journal called Synthese, which means synthesis in German. And it's a top-tier philosophy journal devoted to epistemology, which is the study of knowledge, and the philosophy of science. You can find it if you simply Google my last name, Keas, K-E-A-S, and then the word virtues. Now, I wrote this particular article for my peers, but I'm now in the process of producing more popular spin-offs, such as this video clip. Now, if you Google my name and virtues, you'll find this essay published in Synthese. And if you just read the first couple of pages, which are fairly accessible, you'll see a list of 12 theory virtues. And if you want to dive into the rest of the essay, be my guest, or try to find some of my other resources that break these out in a more popular fashion, ones I'm developing at the moment. So it turns out that many disciplines, not just in the sciences where I focused my research, in those disciplines you can recognize good theories by similar traits as the ones that I've identified, these dozen traits. So I'm actually inviting interdisciplinary dialogue over what are the traits of a good theory in, let's say, the discipline of history or the discipline of philosophy or in any discipline. And of course, I've focused my research primarily on science. So one of the reasons I agreed to be on the board of Ratio Christi is this is an organization devoted to thinking about whether there are good reasons to believe in Christianity from disciplines like history, philosophy, and science. I also do some teaching at Biola University, where I have colleagues who also think along these lines. And so for these reasons, I'm trying to make get a cross-disciplinary dialogue going beyond just my immediate sort of professional world of colleagues in these organizations, and also among historians of science and philosophers of science, but also in other fields. Now, I have one popular spinoff of my work that's just out. It's a book called Unbelievable, Seven Myths About the History and Future of Science and Religion. And in this book, I look at seven stories that make Christianity look anti-science, when on closer inspection, these stories are unbelievable. So, for example, Christianity is made to look anti-science when the story is told, well, during the Middle Ages, when the church had great power, Christianity held back the growth of science. But when you look at the details, you find that actually the typical medieval student had more observation-based arguments for a round earth than most university students do today. I've actually tested this because I've taught observational astronomy for about a quarter century at several different institutions, and found, indeed, most, at least American college students have fewer good reasons to believe in a round earth than a medieval student. So that's ironic. So once you get the facts straight about science and Christianity and their history, you'll find that there is much more evidence for a friendly relationship than an adversarial one. Now, there are some episodes like the Galileo affair where it seems to be conflict, but typically in cases like this, there are other factors that really aren't essential to the Christian worldview that help explain why there was at least apparent conflict between science and religion in these cases. So I've been talking about really three kinds of goods: cultural good, moral good, and intellectual good. Cultural good would be, well, is Christianity good for science? Is there cultural evidence over time, by looking at the historical record, that the Judeo-Christian tradition has been good for science? I think there has been, and my book, Unbelievable, tackles that question. How about a good person? Well, a good person is a moral person. That's an intrinsic good. Cultural factors like Christianity leading to the growth of science, that's an instrumental good. It's good. You can make the argument Christianity is good for the growth of science. But moral good is arguably an intrinsic good. It's just simply good to be a good person, to be honest. For example, report your data honestly if you're a scientist. And then, of course, there's the intellectual good, that is the kind of virtues that you try to cultivate in your theories, called theory virtues or theoretical virtues. And this is what my research has focused on, particularly this last kind of good. So, done a lot of thinking about this, and I really would like to get some interdisciplinary dialogue going on these theory virtues. So if you go to my article by just simply Googling Keas virtues, you'll find my email address on that article. Send me an email if you want to get some conversation going. For example, historians, if they want to explain some event or a series of events in human history, they need to come up with a theory that, well, has evidential accuracy, which is one of the theory virtues. Another theory virtue is durability, a theory that's able to stand up under testing over time. And so, for example, one question in history is, what happened to Jesus after he died? Did he rise from the dead, or did he just stay dead? Well, you have to take a look at the historical evidence and then try to infer the best explanation from the available evidence. Well, what would count as best? That is, what would count as a best explanation? Well, the criteria that historians and philosophers have found are called theory virtues or theoretical virtues. So again, go to my essay and you'll see about 12 virtues, many of which do apply to the doing of history, that is human history. But many of them apply to other disciplines as well. So we've been talking about science, faith, and origins. We've been thinking about questions like, what's the best explanation for the origin of Christianity? And there's a good case that the resurrection was a big part of that. That is, that the resurrection is the best explanation for the origin of Christianity. You could also ask, what's the best explanation for the origin of life? That would be a case of natural science applied to natural history as opposed to human history. And again, what counts as a best explanation needs to be cashed out in terms of theory virtues, which historians and philosophers of science, my colleagues, have been working on for over a century. So let's take one case study to sort of cash this out, to make sure you're getting this, why attention to theory virtues is so important in science, faith, and origins. What about the origin of the major kinds of life? Now, there's two major theories about this, Darwinism and design. Let's focus just on one major argument for Darwinism and against intelligent design, an argument from junk DNA that became prominent back in the 1970s. And let's sort of trace the track record of this theory from the 1970s to the present, in brief. So back in the 1970s, a number of biologists were noticing that in the human genome, that is, in the DNA, in each cell cell in our bodies, there appeared to be a lot of junk, that is, useless DNA, parts that definitely didn't code for proteins, and it didn't appear to have any other function. Well, how was this junk DNA argument used in favor of Darwinism and against design? Well, it seemed that Darwinism, as a complete system of hypotheses, made sense as a whole to think of evolution by means of natural selection, acting on random variations, that over time, there would be a lot of leftover variations in the genome, that is, in our DNA, that are just useless pieces of junk, that just are sort of our hitchhikings, just happen to stay in the DNA despite the fact that they're not really helping us. Biologists such as Richard Dawkins argued exactly this in 1976 in his book, The Selfish Gene. Well, it turns out that as time wore on, scientists began to discover that some of this junk had function. But initially, in the 1970s, the evidential accuracy, apparently, of this junk DNA argument for Darwinism was very high, and it looked like bad news for one component of design theory. So junk DNA argument for Darwinism, high in one theoretical virtue, evidential accuracy. It also seemed to be high on the criterion of internal coherence. That is, the idea of leftover junk within our genome seemed to fit well, really well, with the other components of Darwinism. So those are two examples of theoretical virtues that seem to be very strongly expressed in the junk DNA argument for Darwinism in the 1970s and following. I'll give you another example of someone who made this argument who was not an atheist like Richard Dawkins, and this would be evangelical Francis Collins. He, in 2006, wrote a book in which he said that about 45% of the human genome is junk. And so evidence that it wasn't directly designed by God, but of course, as an evangelical Christian, he thought it was indirectly guided so that even though it looks unguided from science, but with the eyes of faith, he believed that God did it. So that was his argument in 2006. And he even said this. He said, unless one is willing to take the position that God has placed this junk DNA there to confuse and mislead us, we need to believe that God used some kind of Darwinian process to put it there. Otherwise, its presence would seem to mislead us. Well, that was 2006. In 2007, the very next year, Collins gave a press release noting that there's now evidence available to challenge this long-standing view of junk DNA. In 2010, he published another book in which he said that, and I'll quote, "The discoveries of the past decade, little known to most of the public, have completely overturned much of what used to be taught in high school biology. If you thought that the DNA molecule comprised thousands of genes, but far more junk DNA, think again." Now, what's ironic about this quote is he's saying that in the past decade, a lot of discoveries have shown this to be a myth, but his own book back in 2006 was during that very decade when scientists were discovering this, the fact that most human DNA is not junk. And this became very, very clear that in the year 2012, when a major international research project called ENCODE, which stands for Encyclopedia of DNA Elements, was published. And this ENCODE project showed that over 80% of the human genome, that is our DNA, has some function. And they predicted that much more would be identified in the near future, which has in fact come to pass. So reviewing Dawkins just a bit, remember Dawkins back in the 70s was saying junk DNA, great argument for design, or for Darwinism against design. And it just so happened he was on a BBC show in 2012 in the very month, September, when the ENCODE project was released. And he was having a dialogue with a Jewish rabbi. And the Jewish rabbi just happened to know about this ENCODE project and pointed it out to Dawkins as a piece of evidence against Darwinism, as argued by Dawkins himself on the basis of junk DNA. Dawkins' response was interesting. Richard Dawkins responded by saying, well, based on Darwinian theory, we should expect usefulness, not junk, because natural selection acting on random variations, will find eventually what's useful and preserve that. So that's ironic, isn't it? So now if we look at the track record of this junk DNA argument for Darwinism over time, what we find is initially it seemed to be high in the theory virtue of evidential accuracy and internal coherence. That is, it seemed to fit very nicely with the rest of Darwinian theory. But now, fast forward to 2012, the junk DNA argument for Darwinism, how does it stand? Well, it lacks the theory virtue of evidential accuracy. It lacks the theory virtue of internal coherence because Darwinism had to be refashioned in a kind of an ad hoc way, as philosophers call it, sort of for the moment, because there was this disconfirming evidence. And so they had to go back and say, well, we really need to reformulate our theory so it fits this new evidence. And if a theory does this repeatedly, makes these ad hoc moves, this does not inspire confidence. In fact, there's one last theoretical virtue I want to explain to you. It's called durability. And this is tracking a theory over time. Does it hold up under testing? So the trait of durability basically is the idea, does a theory in any discipline, history, philosophy, science, whatever, does a theory, does it hold up under testing? Now, in the natural sciences, this testing tends to be very, very rigorous, but it can be done also in other fields. Remember that Dawkins in 76 said we should expect, basically he's making a prediction, we should expect more and more useless DNA to be discovered. We found the opposite. And so this disconfirming evidence brought the trait of durability down a few notches for this branch of Darwinian thought. So what have we learned from all this about science, faith, and origins? I think, first of all, what we've learned is that whenever a theory has to be repeatedly sort of tweaked and massaged just to evade evidence that doesn't fit it, this does not inspire confidence. And if there's a number of these ad hoc changes, that eventually it's time to dump the theory. But notice, to identify that, you need to keep track of the history of any discipline and the theories in those disciplines to better evaluate the theories. And so this is how my expertise in the history and philosophy of science is very useful for evaluating theories across the disciplines. And I'm really excited about this interdisciplinary dialogue that I'm getting going and hope to continue. And that's why I've written a number of resources for it and will continue to do so. So check out my book, Unbelievable, and my other resources on theory virtues, and see what you think. Shoot me an email if you think that this makes sense of theories in your discipline and how to best evaluate them.